All right, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, thank you again for your patience. All right, when we talk about competency in laparoscopy, actually it took me quite some time to actually try to figure out what I actually wanted to share with everybody. I think for the last 2 decades, I think people like Honorable Dr. Selva, even Dr. Kuna has passed his time and has already retired, but still actively doing laparoscopy in private centers, I believe. We have been trying to push for more and more people to actually practice laparoscopy. And we find that it is not a very easy task to do. You know, we have a lot of challenges, a lot of issues pertaining to availability of people, young ones who actually are well been motivated to actually train, but probably do not have the opportunity to do so. Okay, so I think everybody agree with me and believe that the practice of medicine has always been evolved. The most important thing is that if you compare medicine, drugs, and surgical technique, you see that the fast variation of surgical technique changes over the years. You know, the last 2 decades we had laparoscopy. Now we had a single port laparoscopy, and then we have robotic laparoscopy that comes in together and in one time. You know? And easy example is that when we started off cesarean section during those years, decades and decades ago, we had to do a upper segment section as a mode of most accepted way of delivering babies. But now we know that it is not the best way, and we change from doing a mini laparotomy in bilateral tubal ligation into a laparoscopic tubal ligation. So we learn to accept and adapt, but we find that accepting and adapting a laparoscopic technique is not an easy task. You know, it's not an easy task for the part of the people who actually wants to train, as well as people who wants to actually get trained and do laparoscopy. So I will try to look into factors which can actually help you all to be a bit competent. I mean, this is probably my own formula of recipe to be competent based on my observation of previous experience laparoscopy as well as myself. Now, before that, just a share with you. For the last 2 decades, we have been doing laparoscopy in our hospital. We find that if you separate our laparoscopic figures and laparotomy figures, we find that we can actually leave laparotomy to only 10% of cases, you know. So most of the cases, about 85 to 90% of cases, you can actually do laparoscopy for gynecological surgery. You know? So the vast need for change is there. You know, you can actually have you can actually do laparoscopy in almost all of the gynecological cases, you know. And this is something that everybody should know, that we have already proved it. You know, we have for the last 20 years, I'm sure, I believe our counterparts in various countries who has been practicing laparoscopy believe that this is also true, you know, even in not only in benign cases, but as well as also in malignancy cases also. Now, looking to that, we also want to share with you what are the things that can be done laparoscopically. Of course, we started off with the most simplest one, that is your sterilization. You will get about almost 100% of cases, okay, more than 90% or 100% of cases you can do laparoscopically. So, and then of course, your diagnostic scope. Ectopic pregnancy is also one of the cases that can and must be done laparoscopically. Even cystectomy, more than 90% cystectomy in pregnancy. We have published 2 papers from our hospital sharing everybody for the last 20 years our figures of cystectomy in pregnancy, which was done before at the most of about 20 weeks of pregnancy. And of course, we also look into the hysterectomy part. Okay, more than about 60 to 70% of hysterectomy can be done laparoscopically. Now, of course, myomectomy, the lowest figure, yeah, that can be done laparoscopically, about 60%. Okay. So how do you actually get into the rhythm of being competent in doing laparoscopy? Okay. Now, I divide in this into four factors. First is skill. Okay, I think anyone who wants to be good in anything, they have to acquire some skill. You cannot be thinking that you can do it and you can do it, but you don't actually train yourself, get yourself trained to actually to be skillful in anything that you want to do. Okay. Second thing, we will look into the technique. Of course, if you have skill but you do not know what is the correct technique to apply, probably it's going to be very difficult for you to complete and to become competent. And of course, the third thing, I think, which we agree, in those days, the support of doing laparoscopy in major cases were very, very low. But I believe now, I think a lot of even our senior gynecologists in our country believe that it can be done. It's just that they are not skillful enough to do it. So there is support. There is a leeway to actually open up opportunity for young surgeons to actually do this surgery. All right. So support is important. And of course, the technology. So as we advanced last two decades ago, we have just a very small monitor, not even a high definition camera, just a medical grade camera system, which consists of they call it the RGB camera control unit. And now up to now, we have 4K as well as 3D laparoscopic. So we look into all these factors and try to make everybody understand. So probably, I hope with this sharing, you will know what are the areas that you want to look to. Now, for skill, I think a lot of people who actually pass and become specialists are skillful. Even if you are just a medical officer, you are already a person who actually has some ability to do some things. It's just whether you want to do it or you have focus enough to actually do it, right? So we will start off, one is to recognize what are the targets. So you have to know what you want, what are the targets that you have to achieve when you want to do laparoscopy. So in order to understand the targets, I put this mnemonic here, but I will discuss that again. We will look into your ability to do depth of perception, to be efficient, to be able to coordinate both hands, you know, to be able to complete the task on your own, as well as to handle how soft and how rough you are in handling your instruments. Now, once you have recognized what the targets you need to achieve to acquire that particular skill, it's good to do it in a repetitive manner. You may not be able to do it in a patient, so you have to have some form of your own training module. Some people, I'm sure good surgeons, they are passionate enough, they buy the endo box on the net, or they get some, they design on their own, they start practicing suturing, or they start to try to learn how to coordinate things with the looking at the monitor, as well as, you know, doing suturing in their own endo box. Okay, so these are the self-training module that you can do. And of course, if you have the opportunity, you are in a laparoscopic center, or you have your senior most people who are familiar in laparoscopy, you should try to be assist as much as you can. You know, assist, you know, you try to assist, because if you assist one surgeon, you may have acquired different types of technique if you you compare if you assist another surgeon. And of course, if you are really good, you start with small cases. Try not to be too ambitious. Let's say you have a myomectomy of 3 to 4 fibroids, you know, and you are the only one there, you do not have a good team, you know, and you spend hours and hours trying to get the myoma out, and then let alone not starting suturing or delivering the myoma yet. So start small cases. Once you get better, then you start to get into the more difficult one. So sometimes some people they want to do it so much that they don't actually really take note of the effect of the prolonged surgery to their colleague as well as to the patient. So start small, okay? You have to respect the time and space, meaning that if you want to do a case, you find that this is the first time that you do, try to get somebody senior to come with you and try to start the case small and learn slowly, right? And of course, the other thing is that you need to practice and practice and practice. You need to suture and suture and suture, because practicing will actually get you to become better and better. So you don't get, because laparoscopic is not something that is natural. You don't actually do operation. You open up, you use your hands, which you usually do. So you are using intermediate instruments. Okay, you have to hold it, and then you are going towards the area of concern. So you have to practice, because this is something that you don't do. Apart from doing that surgery, you don't do anything else with that type of method, apart from doing laparoscopy. Yeah? So you have to practice. So it's good if you are passionate, you want to learn, you want to become good, you have to have your own endobox and practice on your own. And of course, the most important thing, I think, which I think helps a lot, is that when you record and you analyze, no, is the purpose of recording is not, if you want to share the patient is one thing, but the purpose of recording is just to see your own technique. No, sometimes when you see, you know that, hey, I should have done this, you know, yeah, I should have made this, or this is how I should push it, or my assistant should actually point it this way. So you will actually help you to progress, you know, because sometimes when you're on your own, nobody actually can criticize you, but you can compare. If you are a surgeon who really are passionate about doing laparoscopy, when you see you have seen a lot of people doing it, you have attended workshop, you have seen people showing videos of how they do it, you can actually compare how you actually perform on the screen compared to others, right? Now that is on the skill part. Now these are the I was talking about my mnemonic just now, the DEBAT, okay, DEBAT. So these are the skills target to achieve in self-guided goals. Now, GOES is actually one of the scoring system that was actually produced by a Canadian group to look into actually assessing person, whether they are actually good or ready to progress to a certain stage. I use GOES in my dry lab to see whether this doctor is good enough to do it on the patient. Okay, so there is a scoring. So you have depth of perception, you have biomanual dexterity, efficiency, tissue handling, and autonomy. So you have then divided into four, and each one will have the maximum of 5 points. You know? So to get a maximum of a good surgeon, I mean, it would have it was in the study, it was said that you have to have half of it. So that means about 13 to 14, you consider as you have actually achieved some form of moderate skill to actually proceed with doing on live surgery. So these are the things. Eh? So we just look into what are they. Okay. Now, biomanual dexterity is basically biomanual dexterity is basically your ability to work. Your left, you look at this person, he has two instruments. One right and one is left. So they are actually communicating with each other. So this is what we call biomanual dexterity. So this is a relatively good biomanual dexterity because one hand is helping out the other hand. Sometimes when you do scope, you find that a lot of your surgeon do with only one instrument because they are so familiar with one hand, they cannot actually use the other hand. So they lost that focus when doing a surgery. Okay? So this is biomanual dexterity. This is the thing that you have to achieve. Sometimes when I said to you, when I command, where is your other hand? What are the other hand is using? You find that you are just using one hand to actually do the operation. Okay, so that is a waste of ports. Okay, that's why sometimes when I do surgery, if I see that my assistant is not enough to understand how to handle the instruments, I don't make the port. Because if I make the port, I find that it will actually no objective, you know, it doesn't actually help the surgery, and it doesn't make the surgery much more easier. Okay. Now, these are example of another biomanual dexterity of extreme case, you know, in which they only use one instrument, okay, to do the process. Okay, it can be done, but in simple process like this, you might be successful. But if you need to do some evisceration or something like you want to do an edentulysis, definitely you cannot perform it. Okay. And of course, this is the third thing is the second thing is the depth of perception. Depth of perception is your ability to judge distance between an object in front of you and object in, at the back of you. If you are seeing now my hand, you find that it's a flat, it's the same. But when I see it with, in to me, I can differentiate the space. Okay, but to you, because you are seeing on 2D flat screen, okay, with a monocular vision, so you will see as if it is in the same plane. Okay, so this is depth of perception. See, what you get is that you try, there is a rod here. Okay, you put the hollow button inside the rod. Okay, see how difficult it is. So if you have a high resolution camera, you can see better, so your depth of perception is better. Okay, so this is a relatively good depth of perception. Okay, of course, your ability to judge the space also rests on your assistant. Now, if the assistant is actually focusing far away from your from the area that you are doing surgery, it might be more difficult. Okay, so this is how you gauge whether you are good in a depth of perception or not. Okay, this is a not so okay one. So you have a good depth perception. So from here we can score. Okay, we can score relatively based on the if he is unable to put in the, see like that. So this is considered as one. You know, he is unable to actually put in the button, the hollow button into the rod. Okay. So these are the things that you have to correct. Eh? Okay, well, but then is other thing is the third one is the tissue handling. So when we speak about tissue handling, is how you actually handle tissues, all right? How you drive your instrument through the area of concern. So these are the training for tissue handling. Okay, you can see that. Okay, he take the ring. Okay, pull it up and down. Okay, until it reach the end. Okay, so this is an example of tissue handling. Okay, in an extreme case where your tissue handling is poor, okay, I'll show you one. Okay, when your tissue handling is poor, you are unable to actually go into the loop, all right? So because you cannot get the loop, get the ring through the loop process, okay? And the second last thing is efficiency, okay? Efficiency means your ability to efficiently dissect the tissues.
Excuse me, Dr. Azim, may I just interrupt? Maybe we can have another 2 minutes.
Okay.
Fine. Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah.
Okay, I'll skip this. Okay, so that is your skill that you have to acquire. Okay, now the other thing is, the second thing is the technique, all right? Now the technique is the position, okay? Surgical field and specific approach. Apart from having skill, you actually have to know how to position the patient. Okay, patient positioning, and of course you have to know how to position yourself, as well as you have to know how to position your instrument, such as your manipulator. Now, surgical field is the most important thing that I think a surgeon should know. These are the skill that they have to know, that have to always ensure that the abdomen is always distended, even if you do a surgery with high leakages. Okay, and you have to maximize the use of suction device, okay, for that section and suctioning to clear off any blood or debris during your surgery. And of course, you try not to irrigate during the process of surgery, all right? And specific approach and technique is that, you, okay, after you having the skill of bimanual dexterity and coordinating and having depth of perception, okay, and you can maintain a surgical feel, okay, the other thing that you have to know is that how to actually specifically approach the process of the operation. If you want to do a cystectomy or oophorectomy, how you want to hold the pedicle, how you want to expose the target area, where and how you want to augulate and cut, how you want to do a proctectomy, where do you want to start. So these are the things that you have to understand, that these are the things that you have to do. Now, of course, the third thing, of course, support. I think not only you need your boss's support, okay, you also need a good assistant to assist you. And as well as you need a good team to assist you as well, to make sure that your surgery is, you know, well prepared, and of course the instruments are all in functioning order. And of course, the last thing is your technology. Okay. So having all skill, having the support, having the correct technique, you have to know that you still need a good system. So we have 2D, we have high definition, we have 4K, 3D, and robotic. And of course, these are all systems which can actually help you to do surgery. And of course, the other thing is that you have to know the type of instruments that you actually need to use during the surgery. So this has as I'm sure all of you are aware, but I think you have to go a bit deeper to understand what your instruments are made of and what they can do to you so that you can use it efficiently and optimally. Okay. So I'm going to skip here. Okay. So as a conclusion, I think even if we do 10 or 20 workshops a year, workshop is just an eye opener. You need more to be surgically competent. Okay. So technical training like this needs repetition and repetition. And of course, you need an apprentice training. So you need to follow somebody. You have the opportunity that we have trying to create for everybody. Apprentice training can be actually applied to all. All right, with that, thank you very much. Thank you for taking the extra time.